And I have the pleasure of introducing for the first talk this morning, Lise Autogena, who is a professor of cross-disciplinary art at the Cultural Communication at Sheffield Hallam University. She's also, first and foremost, a media artist, collaborating with Joshua Portman. And we're very happy to have her here to kick off the day in which we'll be looking at artistic practices in light of the Anthropocene. How do we proceed? How do we act from here? So without much further ado, I'll give the floor to Lise. Thank you very much.
My name is Lise Autogena, and I'm an artist from Denmark. And I'm a professor in cross-disciplinary art at an institute called C3RI, which is a terrible name. It's a cross-disciplinary research institute at Sheffield Hallam University in England. And as a research institute, we bring together engineering, science, and art and design across many different areas of research. So cross-disciplinarity is very much a shared approach. Unfortunately, cross-disciplinarity is not very embedded in art education in England today. Art education in England exists to a large extent within big university frameworks, and they tend to be very rigid, which makes it extremely hard to work across disciplines. It also makes it hard to structure teaching around more urgent concerns like things we're discussing here. So there really is a need to look at how art is taught in the UK. As an artist, I've worked for the past 25 years in partnership with Joshua Portway, who is not an academic. He couldn't be here, as he's right now presenting at a conference at Goldsmiths University in London, where they're discussing sort of the same issues as we're discussing here today. It's our sister conference. And yes, of course, it's really depressing times at the moment, and I think we're probably all trying to understand what on earth is going on and how to act in this new world we're finding ourselves in. So it feels a bit difficult moment to stand here and try to make any sense to you at a moment when nothing is making any sense at all. But I will nevertheless try to discuss some projects that we have developed. These are projects that I was asked to talk about here today, and these projects that have developed over very long periods of time. So long, in fact, that when we first started working on some of these projects, then they were responding to a world where the climate change didn't exist yet. But these projects that we started to explore such a long time ago have now become more urgent to try and understand today. I will discuss three projects, one project called Untitled Superorganism, one project called Black Shoals, and one project called Most Blue Skies. Each of these projects, in their way, chronicle our changing ideas about capitalism, nature, and technology. So we will try this. I took this picture with one of those old mobile phones, of a container that was sitting above the clouds at the astronomical observatories in La Palma in the Canary Islands a long time ago. In the early 2000s, we became interested in the particular relationship we seem to have with the sky space, the sort of innocence we have when imagining a blue sky, dreaming of blue skies in faraway places, or the memory we have of a particularly deep and pure and blue sky. But this romantic perception of the pure blue sky seems to sit uneasily with how our concept of nature is increasingly mediated through technology. So we started to wonder whether our perception of the sky space was changing. And in the context of climate change, it seemed important to examine our response to the increasingly complex and problematic idea of nature and its relationship to the technological and social systems we're embedded in. We developed a project we called Most Blue Skies for an exhibition which was part of the COP15 Climate Summit in Copenhagen. And this has probably been our most direct engagement with the problems of an environmental aesthetics. The project was a kind of quixotic attempt to answer a simple childhood question: where is the blue sky in the world? And we approach this problem very seriously, in fact, absurdly seriously. We use the most advanced resources available to us, including satellite sensing, atmospheric modeling, real-time sensor networks, and radio-tip transfer models developed by NASA. This, by the way, is what you saw when you entered the airport in South Korea and you entered the country. When entering the gallery, you would see a modernist square of blue light with the name of the location of the place in the world where the sky was currently most blue. The square of blue light was actually the exact color of that sky at that moment of time. It was square and pure and simple, similar a bit to a James Turrell installation, and it looked like something you would expect to see in a gallery. We had developed a special wide spectrum lighting system for the square of blue light to reproduce the color of the sky as accurately as possible. So the quality of light was rather beautiful, and when looking at the blue square, it was possible to imagine what it must feel like to be standing in that place, looking up at that sky at that moment in time. But behind it was an array of computers, wires, and monitors downloading and calculating satellite data, which simulated the passage of light through different layers of the atmosphere, as it is affected by variations in the pressure and changes in the chemical composition of the air and refracted by tiny particulates. To do these calculations, we used three different satellites, weather stations, 6 million locations, altitude of every place, position of planet, time of day, position of sky, of the sun in the sky for each place, aerosol density, water vapor density, cloud cover, air pressure, amount of reflection from the ground, sea, forest, height of location, proximity to a city. And given the altitude, time of day, latitude and longitude, air pressure, and so on, keep going. We then attempted to calculate the spectrum of radiation reaching the ground and the exact color of the sky for billions of places on Earth. Almost like a stock market ticker, the calculated sky colors would be deposited onto a world map that we had managed to get hold of from the US military. This map had information of all the locations in the world that are inhabited by humans. And as day and night changes, sky colors would appear and disappear. And the location of the most blue sky would change. So the simplicity of this image of the blue sky was only sustained through an extreme amount of processing and technology, and the work purposely struggled to resolve this paradox. We had spent nearly a year consulting with atmospheric physicists, programmers, and color theorists to write the code to do the calculations. While we exhibited this work at COP15, we had this phone call from the UK Meteorological Office, and they sent us an article that was a new thing that evaluated the implications of a geoengineering project that was being considered for solving issues of climate change at the time. The plan was to inject aerosols into the stratosphere and in this way cool the planet. But one of the main concerns was the psychological effects of the world's population living on a planet where there would be no longer blue skies. That was that project. So this title of this project is actually changed. It used to be called Black Scholes Stock Market Planetarium. It's now called Black Scholes Dark Matter, and I will talk about the previous version of the project. Today we are sort of developing this project, and the dark matter is a whole other story. Black Scholes was a project we started developing in the late 90s. This was the times of the dot-com boom, and it was at the height of media interests in all things to do with the stock markets. It was also a time when the financial market was often discussed as a kind of ecosystem with a life of its own, and where the internal dynamics of the markets appeared to be more important than its ties to the real world. We wanted to develop an installation that would visualize the global flows of capital in real time, but the ideas were so ambitious that we were not sure if it was possible to realize them. We knew that access to massive amounts of real-time stock market data was immensely valuable to traders and also security protected. We initially intended the project to be a kind of parody of the sort of the trading desk of the Übermensch, a sort of Mount Olympus from where they would predict the future and survey their creation. We wanted to create a darkened room with a dome ceiling where a computer display would be projected like a planetarium. Audiences would be immersed in a world of real-time stock market activity, represented as a night sky full of stars that would glow as trading would take place in particular stocks. Every traded company would be a star in the planetarium, and stars would flicker and glow as shares were traded on them. They would change in size according to the amount of money being traded. We imagined that the stars would slowly drift across the sky while outlining shapes of different industries and the huge multinational conglomerates like the signs of the zodiac. The movement of the stocks were based on calculated correlations, relationships between the histories of each stock and those of its near neighbors. The stronger the correlation between the histories of the stock prices of any two companies, or if, for example, they were regularly mentioned together in the news, the more powerful the gravitational attraction between them. Over time, the stars would clot together and drift into slowly changing constellations, nebulae, and clusters. That meant that eventually you would get different constellations, like the petrochemical nebula or the biotech cluster. And so a strange order would start to emerge. Through this technique, different industries would then start to emerge as galaxies, and a general disturbance in a section of the market would have a visible effect on the sky. The collapse of Enron, for example, which was happening at the time we were developing it, would cause a black hole where all the companies affected would glow very brightly due to the level of trading and would be pulled together into a single point, sort of black hole, a very powerful vortex. While developing the project, because we didn't know anything about finance when we started this project, we were helped by huge amounts of interested specialists from all over the world, from many different research areas, professions, institutions, companies, and many different cultural backgrounds. And the process of developing the project has involved a lot of collaborators over the years. It was first commissioned for the Tate Gallery in 2000. The installation consisted of a dome suspended in the gallery filled with tens of thousands of twinkling stars. This is actually from the next exhibition. This is from the Tate. No, it's not. Oh, this is from... This is quite confusing, sorry. That's from the Tate Gallery. Every star represented a company traded on stock exchanges, and the system was connected via a real-time Reuters data feed to every major stock exchange in the world. We had to get security clearance from the CIA to use live US stock market data. And it has been an ongoing process to get clearance from all the stock exchanges in the world throughout the years we've been developing this project. Whenever a stock is traded, the star representing the traded company glows momentarily brighter and gives off a light proportional to the value of the exchange. So if you're standing looking over the dome and you see one of the stars that just flickers at that moment, you know that at that exact moment somewhere in the world several million dollars have changed hands. And if you're watching when the New York Stock Exchange opens, the entire sky seems to light up for a minute or so as billions of dollars of overnight trading is settled. and you get depression very much around 3 o'clock in the afternoon, if the project is shown in the UK, that how much everything is focused, how so much money is focused on the American exchanges. Living amongst the stars is an ecology of artificial life forms that feed on the light given off by the trading activity. And they evolve over the course of the exhibition, where they learn to live within a strange world that consists entirely of money. Whenever a stock is traded, its equivalent star produces food for the creatures. And the bigger the trade, the more food is produced. Every creature has a unique DNA code that determines its bodily structure and behavior, a genetic program. And over time, evolutionary pressures will tend to breed successive generations of creatures that will be better at coping with the conditions in the strange world they inhabit. The creatures evolved from first principles, so the ones that were first released into the world couldn't even move. They would just shiver hopelessly and then die. The first creatures that were able to move appeared after a couple of days, and after 3 months a wide range of species developed in the dome, from some very sophisticated creatures that actively searched for food using primitive eyes, to others which would hibernate until food passed by and then spring to life and swarm over it, and others which were unable to move but simply spawned thousands of offspring and literally threw them in all directions and hoped that one of them landed on a source of food. A time of slow trading was difficult for the creatures as they desperately searched out any signs of food. During these times of famine, many of the creatures died. The creatures who survived were those whose behavior and knowledge about the world allowed them to find more food more easily. The final results were impossible to predict. We had guessed at the likely course of evolution. It was likely that early on creatures would develop a simple beliefs about the world, for instance, that a stock proving fruitful today would probably also produce food tomorrow. Later, more sophisticated behavior would emerge, for instance, some creatures developing grazing techniques based on the belief that similar stocks, those in the immediate vicinity, would be behaving similarly. Still, more sophisticated models might develop, such as the ability to recognize periodic movement of patterns of cause and effect. Predators and parasites may eventually develop, perhaps even farmers. The possible range of creatures was wide. A shark-like species of creatures developed that could swim very fast and pick up flashes of food as soon as it appeared. But large, slow-moving creatures were sometimes better able to survive. And sometimes a combination of different forms of life developed to fill different ecological niches. Lots of small, fast scavengers able to survive on little flashes of food, and a few larger, slower, more heavily defended creatures that were able to monopolize a consistent source of food, and a few predator creatures that cruise the space looking for easy prey. These particular creatures here would breed very aggressively when they found food, and they would cause huge swarms which would spread across the dome, eating everything in their path, and eventually die out when nothing is left to eat. So the evolution of the creatures was open-ended, and we don't have any idea how sophisticated they may eventually become. In the late 90s, when we made Black Shoals, when we first started developing it, a change was taking place in how people talked about the global financial system. The language of the study of complexity theory, and in particular of complex adaptive systems, which have been developing since the 60s, emerged into the popular consciousness. These theories had been developed in places like the Santa Fe Institute by interdisciplinary teams of researchers, and many of the ideas had grown out of the study of natural ecologies and the interactions of agent-based systems. And researchers are building agent-based models of the financial system and thinking about using the same models that they have been using to model biological systems. And at the same time, the growing financialization of the economy is being driven by ever more complex financial instruments, whose interactions and behavior were extremely difficult to understand using conventional models. The economy seemed to be booming because the new financial instruments seemed to be able to create money out of thin air. And this led to the runaway speculation that inflated the dot-com bubble. At the time, if you read something like Wired magazine, it was full of praise for the magical power of the financial system. Financialization seemed to be creating an emergent new world which transcended the flesh and blood world of human labor, and it was explained in a new language of complex systems and chaos theory. It's perfectly valid in a way to model the economy in the same way that you might model a natural ecology. They do share underlying mechanisms. But when you do that, it's very easy to assume that you're studying something that, like nature, is pre-existing in the world, that's somehow also a natural phenomenon. Inevitable. But the reality of the economic system is, of course, the result of very human authorship. Ultimately, the financial system, money itself, is created through the retelling of stories and an act of faith. Like language, money is able to perform the primal magical act of creating something out of nothing, but it only continues to exist if you believe in it. Fisher Black and Myron Scholes and Robert Merton were economists who developed a formula known as the Black-Scholes formula, which we used for naming this piece. Black-Scholes also means groups of fish that follow each other, sort of blindly. The formula allowed investors to reliably calculate the value of a financial derivative, therefore theoretically to hedge against risk. They won a Nobel Prize for the idea in 1997, and the same model is still the basis of most of the complex financial instruments traded today. Based on the formula, they set up a company called Long Term Capital Management, which for several years was spectacularly successful but collapsed equally spectacular in 1998. Excuse me. The initial causes of the collapse were complex, but primarily, as always with money, it was simply that investors stopped believing. A crisis of faith caused some investors to pull out of the fund, causing the company to have to pull out of positions they had taken and thereby lose more money, which resulted in a feedback loop causing others to leave. With about $4 million of the investors' money, the company had leveraged positions worth over $1 trillion. And when they collapsed, there was a very real risk that they would take Wall Street and US economy down with them until they were bailed out by the US government. The year of the collapse of long-term capital management, 1998, was also the year we decided to develop the Black-Scholes stock market planetarium. We saw the story as a sort of Icarus myth about trying to control complex systems. It's important that the data feed to the dome was as close to the real time as it's possible to get. Since the first exhibition, Thomson Reuters helped us access data. So Thomson Reuters informed us within a few hundredths of a second about any trade taking place for any of the 10,000 of companies that was represented in the planetarium. Today, Black Scholes, dark matter, is by far the largest consumer of data that Thomson Reuters supply. We consume several times more data than a major hedge fund, for instance. In fact, when we showed the piece in Denmark quite a few years ago, we used the existing data connection of the Danish Stock Exchange, but it wasn't able to cope with the demands of the piece. And workers had to upgrade the bandwidth and infrastructure of the whole stock exchange in order to cope. So when you stand under the dome, look up at the stars, you know you're looking at a large proportion of the world's economy in real time. A single tiny flicker is millions of dollars moving around, and this produces a strange sense of vertigo. On the one hand, there's a sense of power because the piece is designed to make you feel that you're at the hub of all this information flowing into the room from all over the world. But at the same time, there's a sense of losing yourself and of powerlessness in relation to the scale of it. I think there's a sense in which this kind of experience of the sublime is important to the particular aesthetics of data visualization. But this is a tendency it is generally unacknowledged and that we need to be suspicious of, because it's a type of beauty that can result in a sort of paralysis and surrender. It reminds me of a section in Douglas Adams' Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, which describes something called the total perspective vortex, which is supposed to be the most awful punishment imaginable. The total perspective vortex is a machine that attaches directly to the victim's brain and shows him for a moment an image of the entire universe. And on the image, there's a tiny, tiny arrow, and on the arrow is a label that says, "You're here." It's hard to know how to respond to that. So one of the lessons that we learned on our long journey to understand something about the operations of big finance is that the market is only a natural expression of the particular artificial world model that it embodies. In the same way that the artificial life creatures of Black Scholes stock market planetarium were natural expressions of the computer program they existed in. As such, this project questions the current artificial world model that we have come to embody under the influence of speculative finance. The project questions the naturalization of the system of global capitalism, where the market is perceived as a force of nature rather than an artifact of culture. When the global financial system is seen as a natural state, it becomes extremely difficult to step outside this concept of nature. Next project. Untitled Superorganism was a more recent project that we find a bit difficult to talk about. To a certain extent, this project was a continuation of Black Scholes. It's a project that we presented in response to an exhibition called Monument to the Anthropocene, which was curated by Bruno Latour and a few others. One of them, the chair of the International Commission on Stratigraphies Anthropocene Working Group, which was established to determine whether we're now living in the Anthropocene epoch. This event took place just before this meeting. We were a bit skeptical about the concept of a monument to the Anthropocene, so we decided to make a kind of anti-monument, something that could be blown away by the slightest wind. Untitled Superorganism was an installation that consisted of a circle of hundreds of thousands of dead ants on the floor, which gave the gallery a strange, disconcerting, and intense smell. And next to the ants was this video, which was kind of showed as a sort of amateur video. Ants are pretty simple creatures that individually follow fairly simple rules, but en masse, their emergent collective behavior allows the colony to function as a superorganism, solving very complex problems in elegant ways. As you probably know, ants lay pheromone trails behind them when they forage, and they have a simple set of rules which determine how to orient themselves in relation to the other ants around them. An ant mill is a phenomenon that sometimes occurs in army ants when they encounter a situation in which these rules don't make sense anymore. Stuck in a literal feedback loop, the ants will just walk in a circle, marching around and around indefinitely, with every new ant reinforcing the trail and making it harder for the subsequent ants to escape. There have been documented cases of ant mills, hundreds of meters in diameter, containing millions of ants who simply follow each other until they simply die of exhaustion. The phenomenon is the side effect of the intelligent self-organizing structure of ant colonies, which constructs a system for which it's impossible to escape. We don't have a straightforward interpretation of how we feel about this piece of work. It's easy to come up with obvious and overdetermined metaphors. There's obviously a connection between the ants and the alive creatures in black shoals. The creatures in black shoals are growing and evolving and eating and dying in an environment that is entirely artificial but which they experience as nature. The work has a strong effect on the people who see it, as they believe that this ritual of the ants actually took place within the gallery space, and therefore they feel that we have killed the ants. But it is entirely constructed, and the dead ants come from ant farms that breed ants for animal food. I just thought I'd say that. Mm-hmm. There's clearly been a preoccupation in several of these projects with the mechanics of complex adaptive systems and how to develop an aesthetic that incorporates the ideas of complexity theory in a way that relates to our lived experience with more humanity than a picture of a Mandelbrot set. We have often tried to work with the idea of what it means to be an agent and an agent-based model of the world, and how the assumptions and parameters of this model shape our understanding of nature. This is the writing about these three projects, and I just want to say that that today we are not, our work is not just focused on these kinds of projects. We're working on them. A project in Greenland where we have been exploring uranium mining in Greenland and what it means for the decision-making process in Greenland. And we're currently working on a project that involves migration of animals and humans across the Sahara Desert with the UNESCO and the Refugee Council. I was going to show you a piece of work that was entirely different. It just might be good to mention what it is. I don't think we have time to see it. But it's an entirely piece of work, different piece of work that I thought was important to show because it was a...
we have another 25 minutes.
Okay. This is just some images from the project we've been working on in Greenland. This is the entrance to... what may become a uranium mine in Greenland, which is it's a difficult situation where Greenland is trying to get out of a colonial relationship to Denmark. But to do this, the only way really for Greenland is mining, and this is not just a pure uranium mine, but it will become one of the biggest uranium mines in the world if it's happening. Unfortunately, it's positioned in a place in Greenland, which is the only place where you can farm. And so since the Viking times in Greenland, there has been sheep farming in Greenland. And so this uranium mine will literally be placed right in the center of the only area for growing produce and keeping animals in Greenland. Unfortunately, this process of decision making is complex because people don't have a tradition of speaking frankly to each other, so there's a real difficulty in having the conversations about these issues. So we've been working on this, which is exhibited at the moment in Sweden in a project called Perpetual Uncertainty, which is a long project that explores the nuclear Anthropocene. It's an interesting exhibition. But the project I wanted to just mention is something completely different. It was a piece of music which was developed in the North Sea. It was kind of involving communities in the northeast of England that had really struggled because of Thatcher, since Thatcher's closing of the shipbuilding industries a long time ago, but still this kind of density issues going on and the communities never really recovered. But it was a project that used the idea of a performance of, it used the idea of the sound of the foghorn, which is being turned off in the UK, as a kind of way of bringing people together to create a piece of music, which was performed by 50 ships, a foghorn and three brass bands in the North Sea. Ships were positioned like an orchestra and the horns were tuned. And we developed this technology that enabled us to control the moment the sound came in of the ships, because they were pieces of an orchestra, so they were musical instruments. And the sounds they emitted had to arrive in time with the orchestras on land. So we developed this technology that enabled us to control when the sound would arrive in relation to distance, physical distance, atmospheric impact of sound, the temperature and things like that. And it produced the most extraordinary piece of music that took place across miles of sea. And the beautiful thing was that it was performed by people themselves who lived in this area. But in order to do this, to make this piece, everybody had to kind of get involved with this kind of image of what it might be. Imagine the sound it might produce. And so it was kind of only possible to make it happen if you generated a kind of movement of people, a huge movement of people. And in the end, it was many, many thousands of people. But it was for us, as I showed you, this was gallery pieces. This was a very different piece, and the effect of this way of working was for us so much more exciting. So these days we tend to look more at working outside gallery spaces. And we recently went to Singapore and we saw how all these oil containers were sitting in the Singapore Strait waiting for the oil prices to go up, and thought, what an amazing thing it could be to make a record for the oil industry.